Hello, friends. Here we are yet again with another loot run ranked. This time we're going to reserve. I was actually surprised with how many rubles it made per hour. But more on that later. There's your teaser. So here's the idea. And this one might end up actually shying people away from playing on this map, especially if it's people with lower end systems or people that find the underground of reserve specifically to be a bit more maze-like. However, I would challenge you that if you find the reserve underground to be maze-like, work your way through it and start learning it. Because it can actually give some really, really great PvP interaction and allows for some awesome flank play if you're into that kind of thing. Also, fair warning, the idea here is if we're going to go cost effective and the focus is underground, which tends to be more of a CQ environment, we're going to be shooting some kneecaps, boys. Oh yeah, that's right, we're going KS23. You know we are. All right, so strap in, here we go. First, the map. So here is the outdoor section of reserve specifically, and I'm using a website called mapgenie.io, which I actually have found to enjoy very much. The reason why I'm showing you this is because of the spawn points. Now, the most common places, and fair warning, boys, I have like 2,000 raids on reserve. It's probably my most run map by far. The most common spawn points are the corners. Now, every once in a while, sometimes you end up getting streaks of it, you'll end up spawning up top at the cliff descent. Usually you end up spawning here on the hill or up here. If that's the case, there are things that we can do there too. This one is a little bit more chaotic than a straightforward, I'm just gonna run stashes kind of thing, because there are some points of interest that you would wanna know, and there are some keys that you absolutely would want to carry. If you have the budget for it, a Red Rebel ice pick with a paracord is also your friend, but it's not necessary as long as you don't mind working your way out to D2. But more on that in a minute. The focus on this is filing cabinets. So notice here we can turn on the filing cabinets and I can turn off the spawn points. And this is the filing cabinet count. I believe there's 66 filing cabinets on the map. That's an awful lot of filing cabinets, an awful lot of drawers. Now, the other aspect of this map that we want to make sure that we also take into consideration is marked rooms. The first marked room is found over here in the corner of this building B. Building B is the RBVO key. So based on the desire to focus on filing cabinets, here are the routes that I would suggest if this is your plan of attack. And keep in mind that the map associated with this is oriented upside down, just so that we're all the same on map orientation. At the very least, I'm going to call the cliff or the radar dish north, and I'm going to call the heat pipe south, just so that we can stick with the orientation of what the map has right now. I'm going to start in Scavlands. I'm going to work my way clockwise around the map and give you guys the loot routes that you want to take. If you spawn in the bunker in the corner of Scavlands, what you want to do is make a direct beeline, kind of strong siding, if you know what that is, the whole way, hold your head down, and run in a direct straight line up into the utility area or the garage, a little storage area, storage shed, off the side, this red rectangle underneath Black Bishop. You want to go straight into the underground. Now, it's your choice whether or not you want to loot the crates along the way as you come through the underground, but as you work your way in, you're going to end up working yourself over to the stairs that lead down into the main area of the underground between all of the different buildings. But in this area, there are 14 altogether, and I would suggest you loot all of them if you can. What you want to do from here is throw the power switch, run either through the offices or around the outside through the main area. If you decide that you want to loot the crates or the grenade boxes or weapons crates along the way, that's up to you. Head up the ramp, go down the stairs as you head out towards D2, and then work your way through the tunnels, ultimately arriving in this area here. Decide to loot these two filing cabinets in the safe room at the far end. Look for aces along the way. Loot toolboxes should you so choose. And then leave down this staircase, ultimately ending up at D2. Now that we've covered the actual filing cabinet loot order, what we want to do is now look at the other spawns and the order in which you want to go for those. So if you spawn at the PMC spawns by Hole in the Fence, by the small tower, what I would suggest is you make a beeline directly into Black Pawn. The reason why is because if you get down into Black Pawn in the basement, you have the opportunity to loot the marked room inside of Black Pawn because you will be the first one there. Now, as soon as you walk into the underground, you can run down straight down through this ramp, take a right, and you will end up in this area to do the looting and then obviously leaving through D2. If you spawn at either spawn on the cliff descent, you want to make sure that you have both the KORL key and the KPRL key. KPRL ends up opening this security shack that has two additional safes in it, a weapons crate, and also some other loose spawns for things like intelligence. Also in here, there is an additional safe and two other filing cabinets, and there's also some loose loot for weapon attachments, etc., sitting in an open box here on the floor. Because if you spawn here and you want a quick exit and you don't care about find and raid status, you have the ability to use the Red Rebel to leave. If you want to wait the 7 minutes to get find and raid status, you can let the clock tick down and use the cliff descent extract as soon as you get the 7 minute mark. Or you have the ability to open this door, head down the stairs, and work your way down the long spiral staircase inside of the tower into the basement and loot your filing cabinets, hit the power switch if the power's off, and go back out through D2 if you want to. Now, for the next few spawns, as you end up going around the outside edge here, basically the idea that I have chosen for myself is to run through killing fields, run around the outside edge of the ST warehouse building, and head over around through this field here, loot the two filing cabinets in this little brick shack, and then head up cliff descent, see if these two buildings have been looted. If they haven't been, loot them, and then I can make the decision as to whether or not I want to leave through cliff descent or not. If I head downstairs, I just follow the same loops that I've been doing right along. And that is true all the way down through until the spawn here in this corner in the far B building. If I spawn here, I'm going to run into the other B building and loot the marked room, hop out the window, and continue the same path that I did, kind of looking for PMCs along the way and see if there's anybody that I need to shoot. For me personally, unless I spawn here, I don't bother trying to get into the other B building to try to get marked room loot. Now, for any of the associated spawns down here in the south, for me, it's I end up kind of skirting along the K buildings up through on the railroad tracks. I'll take a left into Bishop here, into White Bishop. I go down into the basement, and then as soon as I get down into the basement, I work my way over to the door and head down into the Ratacombs. Okay, so those are the major loot routes that I personally take. You can add any flavor to this that you want to. As we roll the B-roll, here are the pros and cons of this loot run. The first is that there are a ton of loot points. There are weapons crates, loose ammunition, filing cabinets especially, grenade boxes, med containers, you name it. Reserve has loot everywhere. It's got a very, very decentralized loot system. And because of that, it seems like the player base itself, when it comes onto this map, the people that are in this map's lobby, tend to be pretty spread out and kind of stay that way until they end up getting to points of interest or somebody rings the dinner bell and people go running. So because of that, there is a wide variety of loot, especially when it comes to filing cabinets. Insofar as the filing cabinets themselves, you do have the ability to get an awful lot of different stuff, up to and including things like gold skull rings and Bitcoin and stuff like that that are on the loot pool. They're just crazily rare. But you can very often get computer parts, power banks, toolkits, things that may not by themselves have a whole lot of inherent value, but you can fill a bag very, very, very quickly and work your way toward an extract without having to have wasted so much time running around and looting a whole bunch of different points. Also, because of the marked rooms themselves being as spread out as they are, you have the ability to access marked rooms on a pretty regular basis because you end up being the person that spawned next to it. Now, the last point here is kind of a mixed bag because it's going to depend on somebody's individual ability. Reserve is a unique map in that it spawns raiders. There are two switches that do that. When that happens, especially underground, there's about a 30% chance that raiders will spawn underground. There is also a small percentage chance that raiders will already be underground when the raid begins. We saw it happen over the course of 5 hours, 3 different times. And pulling the power switch ended up netting us 2 different spawns of raiders when it happened as well. As a pro, there's an awful lot of potential to get some really, really good gear, ammunition, and guns off of these raiders if you decide that fighting them is for you. And I know that there's an awful lot of the player base that enjoys fighting raiders. So it's a good place to be able to get your beak wet with that kind of stuff without having to eat the cost of a lab's access key. And if you are somebody that is capable of getting those kinds of kills, you have the ability to get some very, very high value stuff. The map is spread out. So you're not going to be able to just run or blitz a specific section of the map every single time and loot this with reckless abandon. You have to be able to get there first unless you're lucky enough to spawn close by. And that will not happen every time. Maximizing this map and its loot potential also requires a handful of keys. The keys that I would recommend are KORL, KPRL, RBVO, RBBK, RBPKPM, and you also, if you decide that leaving through an alternative extract is for you, would want to have a Red Rebel and a Paracord, although that isn't necessary. Now, I had a Red Rebel and a Paracord, and I opted to take the cliff descent on a couple of different occasions. However, in opting to take the cliff descent, I still ended up being killed by PMCs that were guarding that area at the same time. So it doesn't necessarily provide a benefit to anyone if you can't get out through that way either. Even on a low population server, there seem to be a lot of people around. So, another con is that PvP is going to happen, and it's going to happen often. This is a popular map. It's probably the most popular map at the moment. Because it's so popular, you're going to run into people. So, do this with the assumption that you're going to end up dying a considerable amount. The underground associated with reserve specifically gets very busy. There are scavs, there are raiders on regular occasion, and then there are people that want to go and fight those raiders on regular occasion. And you're going to need inventory space. For the purpose of this, I filled not one, but two scav junk boxes, five eye cases, three docks cases full of keys, and I have filled one ammo case. So there's a lot of loot. Okay, now that we've talked about pros and cons, let's talk about our gear loadout for the purpose of the cost. We're not trying to snipe people or engage in PvP at mid-range, so the gear that I chose to run for this is a shotgun. So of course, for shotguns, I chose the heavy hitter. We went with the KS-23. We're going for those sweet, sweet kneecaps. It does stand to note that most raiders do not have face shields, so aiming for the head with raiders obviously pays off nicely because we're sending 8 pellets toward their head instead of a single round that could miss. And then we're going to bring an F5 backpack and whatever chest rig you would like. For me, I decided I was going to use an A18 because that provided a little bit of armor, but if you're somebody that likes additional space, you can always go for the belt A and B rig. Now, all in, the cost ends up running us somewhere around 150,000 rubles, and we died 8 times. We also ended up repairing a Gen 4, and we also repaired a Slick, both of which were zeroed out. All in, total losses that we experienced for the duration of our 5-hour run on this ended up totaling 1.1 million rubles. Ouch, right? Well, hold on. In the same token, however, our barter loot alone netted us 4.7 million rubles. In the vast majority of the loot that we ended up selling off, I just underwrote as miscellaneous vendor trash. So we didn't even really cash in as much as we possibly could have. I didn't really min-max this all that much. But we made 4.7 million rubles in just barter loot. Between the total other loot, including loose euros and dollars, totaled 3.6 million rubles. And then the miscellaneous vendored trash keys were another 260K, and then our ammo was another 382K for a total amount of money earned, total earnings, 8.7 million rubles. If we take our cost out, we have an earnings per hour of 1.5 million and an earnings per raid of 400,000 for 19 raids. Slightly lower raid count, much higher value per raid. Hey everybody, Editor Onepeg here. I realized that I actually have a miscalculation in the recorded video that I made for y'all. So as I was going through this, I realized that I had an entire holodelnik bag with a bunch of food in it that I didn't include in the initial calculations, which is all of this highlighted bit here. That actually increases the earnings per hour by another 60k rubles. I know it's really minuscule, but figured I should include it anyway. So there you go. For those of you capable of beating raiders, and those of you capable of winning in PvP, this makes an absurd amount of cash. Especially if you're able to loot some stuff along the way. Things like marked rooms end up paying out in droves. This isn't even getting crazily lucky, because the vast majority of the value that came from this was from stuff like flash drives and diaries, AA batteries and stuff that you find all over the place in filing cabinets. Like, the most common loot was the things that made us money. We got 14 pieces of blue tape. I mean, you're talking 175K just in blue tape. The reliability of the run actually comes from the filing cabinets themselves. the PvP side of it, or the PvE side of it, was only 3.6 of the overall money. It's 50%, 50% more money per hour than what we were seeing out of any of the other raids so far. So right now, Reserve Underground Cabinets are king. Which loot run's going to take the crown? I don't know, but we'll see. So let me know which one you want me to run next. We'll see you in the next raid. All right? Peace.